evening. My name is Eve Love, and I'm with the St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Commission. We are an advisory group to the St. Mary's County government, and we meet regularly and talk about issues that might impact our local historical sites and neighborhoods. But we also like to have some education for the community, so we have started having these programs, and we're so thankful that you came out to join us tonight. We do have a sign-up sheet that's going around, so please sign in if you don't mind. But tonight we're very happy to welcome Ruth Mitchell. She's from historic St. Mary's City, and I had a chance to hear her presentation last spring when it was Archaeology Month at the historic St. Mary's City, and I just found it a fascinating presentation. That any time that they want to put in a sidewalk at St. Mary's College, you just don't go and start pouring concrete. You've got to put everything on hold and do a little digging first and explore what's there so that you don't, so that you can protect what you have. So with no further ado, I'd like to welcome Ruth and let her begin her presentation. I hope you find it as interesting as I did.
Thank you, Eve, and thank you, St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Commission, for hosting this lecture and inviting me to speak tonight. see if I can get the technology going. For those of you that have lived in St. Mary's County for a while, you're probably familiar with a number of the large archaeology projects that Historic St. Mary City has conducted over the years, many of which date to the 17th century, such as the work at the St. John site, where we installed a new exhibit 12 years ago, or the chapel project where we recreated the 17th century brick church, or the ongoing work that we're continuing to do at the Calvert site, the 17th century house built by Maryland's first governor, Leonard Calvert. Tonight, though, I'm going to talk about smaller scale projects that we've been conducting over the past year and a half. In addition to all of the excavations at St. Mary's City, these kinds of projects occur all of the time. They tend to be on college campus, but sometimes they're on historic St. Mary's City's grounds. And they usually related to new infrastructure that's going in. Sidewalks, for example. St. Mary's has had a long history of students walking in the roads. And here we have a 1920 shot of students attending the St. Mary's Female Seminary, walking in the road and trying their best to stay out of the mud. Having these old photos can be so valuable to us, and just looking at this one in particular, which is a south-facing shot with Trinity Church behind the photographer, there's so much detail, such as notice the white picket fence on your left, which leads into an even different style fence further down the road on the left and as well as on the right. Our first sidewalk project was along the edge of Trinity Church Road, also known as State House Road. Students trying to get to classes in Kent Hall tend to come up the street off of Route 5, and that's where the problem area was located. We actually investigated this area in the 1990s for another project. During that time, a major renovation was slated for Kent Hall, and this parking lot was going to be turned into a smaller parking lot, and additional infrastructure would be installed. We excavated a number of 5x5 foot test units that were in areas that were going to be impacted. A chiller building was slated for construction along the edge here, as well as new utilities going in throughout the site. The timing never seems to work out for us, and in this case, we started the project at the beginning of the winter. As if that wasn't bad enough, the slope that we were excavating on was a bit of a nightmare. This is one of the most remarkable examples of stratigraphy that I've ever worked on. After removing the grass, we came down onto an old tennis court surface, and below that, 11 additional layers. When teaching students about stratigraphy, I often refer to layers of a cake. And this time, it really does look like cake layers. It isn't until we get to the bottom, where you see that dark layer, that we begin to understand what the original ground surface was like, and there is an intact cloud deposit there below all those layers of fill that have been deliberately added over time. Now that you're familiar with stratigraphy, I'll confuse you even more with these two images from that project. If you focus on the bottom image and start near the bottom of the square, The dark band at the bottom is the original plow deposit. And then when you look at the layers above, it's clear that they were trying to level out the ground surface. And then you look at the unit in the upper right, and it seems they went in the opposite direction, changing the way the slope went. So when things just start to make sense, we still have puzzles to work out. And what did we find during this project besides challenging soil layers? Out of the 11 units, we excavated just over 38,000 artifacts. Sounds like a lot. Until you realize that 18,000 of them are oyster shells, and there's a lot of brick too. Much of the brick came from the construction of Kent Hall in the 1930s. And I've highlighted in yellow the objects that we could attribute to the colonial period, with pantile, a colonial roofing tile, being the greatest in number, with only 4 wrought nails, a fairly low number of nails if there's a colonial period building nearby. But there's evidence, plenty of evidence, of St. Mary's Female Seminary with 19th and 20th century ceramics, glass, and glass primarily. The pantile fragments are likely all that's left of the brick prison, which is known to have been on the north end of town. Previous work we've done suggests it was located near Kent Hall, but all traces of it have been wiped out. The historical evidence doesn't offer too many clues, but there is an act in 1674, the second or third of its kind, to build a prison. In it, they describe some specifications, including it should be 24 by 15 feet, made of brick or stone, and that it have sufficient locks, bars, and windows for a prison. We also discovered a large amount of Native American period artifacts, including 68 fragments of pottery, mostly dating to the late Woodland period, which spans from about AD 950 to 1600. There was a fair amount of lithic material, the stone byproducts of making tools. One of the projectile points we found is known as the Orient Fishtail, which dates from a little bit earlier than the ceramic fragments to the late archaic early Woodland period. And so we knew going into this sidewalk project that there was a good chance preserved soils were present and that Native American, colonial, and post-colonial sites are all still preserved here along this edge. The area we're most concerned about was adjacent there to where you see it marked as Chiller Building. And I made a thin red line, the area of impact that we knew there would be preserved soils. And this is the hillside before we began. And you can see there's a lot of tree root disturbance along the edge. And also we've watched over the years as oyster shell has continually eroded out of that hillside. Once we excavated the hillside, we found intact soils just below the topsoil. So we didn't have to dig deeply like those squares, like those layer cakes we did earlier in the 90s. We found several generations of posts, including this utility pole with the wood still preserved, likely from the early 20th century. And we found a dark linear feature that was once part of a fence line. Even though this was just a narrow ledge, just under 10 feet wide, there we have this preserved cultural feature just even in this small little area. Looking at the project area from the other direction, we were digging on the hill by the Chiller Building, and way in the distance you can see parts of Route 5, which kind of curves around in the distance, and we got really lucky when we found this undated photo taken a little further back showing a picket fence. Now, this isn't the same fence that we found, as the style is a little bit different, and the area we're working on is a little bit further down the road, probably in this area near where the pole is located. Notice further down the road the swampland that later was filled in on the left and right side. So for those of you familiar with the campus, on the left side is where the boathouse is currently located. And taking a quick look at some of the other earlier photos, here's an aerial taken right after the reconstructed state house was built, which is in your lower right-hand corner, and before Kent Hall was constructed. It looks like there may have been an earlier tennis court where Kent Hall will soon be, and we have a row of utility poles, but there isn't enough detail in this photo to see if there's a fence there. And this one from the opposite direction, looking up the hill from Route 5. This early 1925 photo shows poles on the right side where our project is, but it's really hard to tell if there's a fence there. And this 1947 image shows a lot of changes, including Kent Hall having been built and Route 5 now having a curve around to the south that was built in, that was added in 1934 in preparation for the tercentenary celebrations. You'll notice some low bollards along the edge here and more robust utility poles in the project area. And there's this early 1915 shot when you'll notice a post and rail white fence in the background. Unfortunately, it's really hard to say where the tennis playing girls, where that photo was taken, but in the background there is water. It could be the river or it could be St. John's Pond. It's hard to say, but it's likely that the same period and style of fence that we saw in that first undated photo that I put in the upper left. And so back to the fence that we discovered. We have to rely on the archaeological data to date it. And from what we've seen, it's likely a 19th century fence, or possibly earlier. Very few artifacts were recovered within it. Moving on to the next project, another sidewalk, a new Americans with Disability Act path, a new ADA path is planned to be installed on campus, which will run from St. John's Pond on the lower end there, along Route 5 and northwards with a boardwalk across Fisherman's Creek, also known as Where It's Pond, also known as Chancellor's Creek, and ending in the rugby fields, also known as Northfield, and also known as Pope's Freehold. Lots of names, places, names get changed a lot around here. When the path gets up to Northfield, or Pope's Freehold, it meanders away from Route 5, which is running along the bottom of your screen there, and goes up a hill and ends up on a service road. And so what do we know about this site historically? Nathaniel Pope, who was the great-great-grandfather of George Washington, built a house here. And in fact, this is where George Washington's great-grandmother, Ann Pope, was born. Pope was granted a 100-acre freehold, built a house there, and then later moved to Virginia, and then later Thomas Hatton pays for a new dwelling near Snow Hill Manor Road, which we presume is located here in Pope's freehold. In 1659, Philip Calvert, who's the Chancellor of Maryland, lived, quote, at my house at Pope's freehold. And then the record basically jumps ahead another nearly 100 years, and Chancellor's Orchard is mentioned in a grant to Robert Toll. 19 years later, Reverend Moses Tabbs has possession of the Toll property. And I just wanted to quickly point out the George Washington connection, because we don't have very many of those in our neighborhood. Here you see Ann Pope marries John Washington, which was in 1658, and then their son Lawrence is born in 59 in Westmoreland County, and so that Lawrence is the grandfather to George Washington. Here's a 1972 aerial photo of Pope's freehold, and the red dot represents the only area where we've ever done any archaeology on the site. Archaeologists from St. Mary's City in the early 70s were interested in finding Nathaniel Pope's house, and so they excavated on this site for 2 summers. There was a big depression in the ground that they thought might possibly be a filled-in cellar from that 17th century building. As they started excavating the site, they quickly realized they had a much later building. They did find a cellar filled with a lot of brick rubble and oyster shell, and large fragments of pottery were found in the cellar, as well as brick steps leading down into it. As they puzzled through the foundations of the site, they were able to get a lot of information about its inhabitants. What they had uncovered was an early building dating to 1750 with a stone hearth on the north end and a brick hearth on the south. The cellar entrance was on the south end as well. And the addition dates to 1765, also has hearths on the north and south sides. I don't know if you can read this, but the details in the historical record also help provide clues to the site. After Robert Toll dies, a resurvey occurs in 1765, which provide the details of an already standing, quote, good dwelling house, brick chimneys, 28 by 16, and also mentions other outbuildings, including a tobacco house and a kitchen. In 1779, Reverend Tabb dies, and the property goes to his son, and then is later purchased by his brother, Dr. Barton Tabbs. After that time, it's leased to tenant farmers until about 1872. You'll notice in this image Route 5 in the background, and it shows exactly what was excavated during that early 1970s work. The early house is on the left, and the addition, which you can't really see, is on the right, and you can't really see it because very little was left of the brick foundation of that. Most of it had been plowed away. After the work was finished, the lab work began, but before that, they decided to reconstruct the foundations of the house to bring the footprint above ground so visitors could see the outline of the building. And then the lab work begins. Historic St. Mary City brought on George Miller as the first lab director of the newly formed organization. George worked at a number of places after he left St. Mary City, including Colonial Williamsburg and many other prestigious and well-known sites, and he recently retired from archaeology. But he began his career looking at the findings from the Toll Tab site. He was the first to really conduct a detailed analysis of the 19th century farmer ceramics, 19th century, excuse me, tenant farmer ceramics in the eastern United States. And this became the basis of an index of economic scaling that he created that are all the archaeologists that I know use when they're looking at ceramics from that time period. This is a slightly younger version of George as he analyzed ceramics from the Toll Tab site. Decorated wares like you see here became much more dominant in the market after 1815. These edge decorated wares of varying styles represent rapid changes in ceramic types over a 70-year period from 1784 to 1857. These changes are subtle, but they can really help an archaeologist parse out the site more precisely by examining the details of the decorations. The whole examples on your right or to give you a sense of the color and style of the plate fragments that were found at the Toll Tab site. The ceramics decorated with a transfer print style also range in date based on color and other attributes, and these styles range from 1800 to about 1860. George Miller was able to recognize that these decorated wares, not just the transfer printed ones, were the cheapest type available with color. The rapidly changing styles of rims and colors made replacements difficult. So George realized that the large variety of decorated 19th century ceramics from the Toll Tab site represented piecemeal purchases rather than whole sets. The Toll Tab site was an excellent one to base such a large study on since it was a continuously occupied by tenant farmers from 1780 till about 1860. This interesting artifact took George Miller down another road of discovery. This is a soup bowl from the Atlantic Lunch, which was a restaurant in DC on 6th Street and Penn Ave. Having the place of origin printed right on the object makes our work a lot easier. He was able to learn about the restaurant and its connections to St. Mary's County through a number of oral interviews with local countyans. The Atlantic Lunch restaurant was located in the Atlantic Hotel, at least until, I believe, about 1925. And these two images show the building that stood there at least until the mid-60s. The Atlantic Lunch was open 24 hours a day, and its connections with St. Mary's County ran deep. This St. Mary's Beacon advertisement from 1913 clearly states that it's not only St. Mary's County headquarters, but that you will meet all of your Southern Maryland friends. And George's interview with Maud Russell, whose uncle owned Atlantic Lunch, states it well. The Atlantic Lunch was the first place they landed when they left the county. Uncle Charlie, he would help them find a job or create one of them, one for them until something came up. She was a cashier at Atlantic Lunch until the 1960s. Another way in which the bonds were maintained was through the purchase of eggs, country produce, hams, sausage, oysters, fish, and crabs, all from St. Mary's County. In addition to buying produce and meat from the county, the Atlantic Lunch served country dishes, including Southern Maryland stuffed ham. This is the Atlantic Lunch was actually moved, later moved into a different building, and so here's a little tidbit of that. I don't know where, this is also on Pennsylvania Avenue, but I don't know the name of the building. Sorry about the Atlantic Lunch digression, but it shows how interesting the information we glean from artifacts can tell us. Back to our project. Here in red, you can kind of see where the work was conducted in the 1970s. In relation to the new pedestrian path that's going in. On the south side of the site, the path is very, very close to the foundations of the Toll Tab's house. When we got out there, we excavated a number of 5x5s. We used those test units to screen soils from the plow zone. And after removing the plowed layer, we very quickly started finding lots of those 19th century decorated artifacts that George so carefully analyzed. And you see them several here with stone as well as stoneware, which is a large base fragment in the middle, as well as a few coarse earthenwares. As would be expected, lots of nails, window glass, brick, etc. And I don't know if you can see it, but there's also that 1970s pull tab from a soda can, or beer can, possibly. On the left is a white clay tobacco pipe bowl fragment with a maker's mark on it, and it's probably from the 18th century, that particular one. After we excavated the units that you see here, we laid out a 10-foot wide corridor, note the area of spray paint, that was going to be impacted by the sidewalk, and we mechanically stripped that area to see if there were any cultural features there. We got busy recording a number, indeed there were a number of cultural features that we had uncovered. We found a number of small post holes, probably representing different generations of fences that came off the back end of the two different, the house and the later addition. Here's an example of what one of those looks like. This is a small shallow post that we excavated. And we found a deposit of oyster shell. The outline of the shell pit is strange and irregular. And when we started digging down, we realized it remains strange and irregular. It was surprisingly deep. And the bottom of the feature and the overall shape of it suggests that it was very likely once a hole created by a fallen tree and then was filled in by Native Americans after they had a feast with oyster shell and other things, and that was thrown into the hole from a tree fall. About 30 feet away from that, we uncovered another shell-filled pit, and this one was also irregular in shape and likely part of a filled-in root ball of some sort. Besides oyster shell, there was not much in these pits, but the smaller one had several fragments of Native American pottery like this shirt here. And some of the larger pieces mend together and are smooth-bodied, and a few fragments are decorated. This is likely a late woodland period type of ceramic. From the colonial period, we found a fence line represented by this linear feature that the girls are pointing to. This fence is interesting. It goes right up to the back side of the Toll Tab's house. And I should point out, it really goes to the back side of the early building. If you follow that dark linear feature, it takes you right to where the entrance is to the cellar on the early portion of the site, the first phase of occupation when Robert Toll was alive. This image might make it a little bit clearer. The red line represents the fence we found, and it runs directly to the back corner of the 1750s house. By the time the 1765 addition was added, the fence was either gone from the landscape or it may have been torn down. We completed the field work on the project last spring, but we still have lab work to do so we can fully document all of the interesting pieces, fragments of pottery that we found. And no doubt we'll heavily be relying on George Miller's classification system. We have several George Miller, we call them cheater's guides, hanging in the lab, like this one, that really gives us a good detail on all of those highly decorated ceramics. This is how the site, on the lower right, this is how the site looks at the moment, with that recreated above ground brick ruin still extant out there. And that upper left-hand image is of the archaeologists in the 70s rebuilding some of the brickwork to bring it up above ground. In case you're wondering, the path has yet to be installed, but the word that I hear around campus is soon, very soon. I've been hearing that since we got the grant awarded in 2012 or 13, so these things take time. A project like this can't happen without all of the laborers, the people that work on the site, including the team, some of whom are in the room tonight. I feel like what was important to me in getting this lecture together is to show you some of the cool things that we find and do at St. Mary City. But the getting there is often very uncool, like spending a morning bailing with your hands the water from a weekend's rain and stretching your back out because you can't move afterwards. sorry, I'm losing my voice a little bit. But so I wanted to thank that team, that hardworking group that is out there even today in the cold. So that's it. Thank you. We were going to open it up. If anybody had any questions, I'm happy to go back over anything. I don't see any hands raised. There's one. He asked if we ever found anything connected to Washington. I can't say that we have. The house that we worked on there was not the house that Nathaniel Pope lived in. We would like to find that house, though. All it takes is time and funding. Anyone else? Well, then I think that's going to be it. All right, thank you. All right, thanks, Ben.
On behalf of the Historic Preservation Commission, I'd like to thank you all for coming and a pleasant evening. Please sign in if you haven't already.